Well, tonight is Super Bowl 55. Anybody excited about that? Kansas City Chiefs and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. If you know me, I could care less. I'm not a football fan. Rebecca's the football fan in our household. But I tell you what I do like. I like the food that goes along with the Super Bowl party. So we're having sliders and chips and dips and all that kind of good stuff at our house. But you know, Rebecca's taught me a couple of things about this game that are pretty cool to think about. First, I'm supposed to cheer against Tom Brady. Amen. That's going to be the best amen I get for the whole message today, cheering against Tom Brady. I'm supposed to cheer against Tom Brady. Second, this competition is pretty cool. It's between an old quarterback and a young quarterback. Tom Brady is old like me. He's 43. I'm 44. Patrick Mahomes is 25. There are 18 years and 45 days between them. And when the Chiefs and the Buccaneers take the field tonight, it'll be the largest age difference between two starting quarterbacks in Super Bowl history. And that fact alone will make the competition fierce, because the young guy is going to have to prove that he's as good as the old guy. And the old guy is going to have to prove that he has still got it. This is also the only Super Bowl between the starting quarterbacks who won each of the two most recent Super Bowls. So both men have something to prove. Both men have records to shatter and set. And while I'll be far more interested in the sliders and chips and dips, I may actually turn and look at the score every now and then just to see which quarterback is ahead. No, I won't either. Think about this. Opponents and opposition. They're a part of sports. They're a part of business. They're a part of law. They're a part of much of life. And we sometimes look at opposition in a negative light. We think that we much prefer no opposition. We think life would be easier. Life would be better if we had no opposition. And yeah, while life might be a little bit easier without opposition, it wouldn't be necessarily better. I mean, think about tonight's game, for instance. With both quarterbacks facing a fierce opponent and having something to prove, do you think that either one of them have spent the last couple of weeks just laying around in their hammock? No. What have they been doing? They've been watching tape of their opponent. They've been talking to coaches. They've been talking to maybe other players who've faced those opponents and have some ideas. They've even been doing the basics of just throwing the football. They have been preparing. Why? So they can better themselves in the face of opposition. Opposition is not necessarily a bad thing. In fact, it can be quite helpful. And the same goes in terms of faith. We live in a day of opposition to the truth of the gospel. And sometimes we might wish everything was easy. But you know what's happened to the church when things were easy? The faith has percolated up like a foam on top of a root beer. And then it has suddenly dissipated. But in the times when there has been some opposition, the church has been strengthened. The opposition caused the muscles of the faith to be flexed, causing it to grow stronger instead of becoming flabby in times of ease. So in the face of opposition, we must be strengthened in our faith. We need to allow the opposition that is in the world to cause us to flex our muscles a little bit, and so that we can be encouraged to do so, and we can even see how to do so. I want us to see how the Apostle Paul did that. So if you haven't already, turn in your copy of God's Word to Acts chapter 25. Now let me set up the context leading up to Acts 25. Last week, we talked about the Apostle Paul telling goodbye to the Ephesian elders. And when we left him there in Acts chapter 20, Paul was saying goodbye. Well, he did leave there, and he headed towards Jerusalem. And he got to Jerusalem, and he was arrested after preaching just about 8 days there. Now, in those weeks before, in his travels to Jerusalem, Paul had been warned several times of the dangers that awaited him there in the city of Jerusalem. In fact, when he visited some believers in Tyre, they had warned him not to go to Jerusalem in chapter 21, verse 4. And then he met with a church in Caesarea, and while he was meeting there, there was this prophet by the name of Agabus who came from Judea to share a vision with Paul of the danger that was ahead of him in Jerusalem. That caused the Caesarean brethren to say, look, Paul, don't go to Jerusalem in chapter 21, verse 12. Well, Paul's response to the people of Caesarea is one of the most outstanding demonstrations of courage and commitment in the entire New Testament. Paul said this in Acts 21, verse 13, I'm ready not only to be bound, but even to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. So, Paul had gone to Jerusalem, knowing he would face opposition. He almost, consequently, immediately was arrested, and that begins a 5.5 chapter account of Paul on trial. First, Paul makes his case with the crowd there in Jerusalem. You know, in the crowd, they get so angry that they say they want to rid the earth of him in Acts chapter 22, verse 22. So Paul then is taken to the Jewish ruling council, the Sanhedrin, and things get so intense, they start fighting so much over Paul that there's a guard that is afraid that Paul is going to get ripped in two by these holy men. And so Paul is taken away. Apparently, the Lord Jesus himself even felt like Paul might need a little pep talk after being in this circumstance. For Acts 23, verse 11 tells us that the following night, the Lord stood near Paul and said, take courage. As you've testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must also testify in Rome. The Lord's word was timely, because the next morning the Jews formed a conspiracy and they bound themselves by oath that they would not eat or drink until they saw Paul killed. Well, thankfully Paul got wind of the plot. He told a Roman centurion who told his commander, and that commander had Paul transferred by night to Caesarea. And listen to the kind of guards he put around Paul. He had 200 soldiers, 70 horsemen, and 200 spearsmen. There wasn't nobody going to touch Paul on that transfer. Well, in Caesarea, Paul went before a guy named Felix, who was the governor of the district of Judea. And when Paul finally got an audience with Felix, the governor passed the buck and said, oh, I'll deal with him later. Well, later never came. Paul sat around for 2 years waiting for something to happen. And then finally, Felix was replaced by a guy named Festus. So Paul went before Festus. Now, Festus didn't really want to deal with Paul either. He just wanted to appease the Jews. And so Paul appealed to Caesar. But in the meantime, Festus had a visit that came from King Agrippa, the guy who was just one up ahead of him. King Agrippa and his sister Bernice were there in Caesarea visiting and checking out things. And so Festus decided he'd discuss the case with King Agrippa. And King Agrippa said, you know what? I think I'd like to hear from Paul himself. So Paul went to Agrippa. And that's where we set up the text for today. Now, as we go into this, I want you to realize this is the fifth defense that Paul is making in Judea. First the crowd, then the Sanhedrin, then Felix, then Festus, now Agrippa. But not only is this Paul's fifth defense, it'll also be his last. And so as such, it is kind of the oratorical climax of the book of Acts. Years before, Paul had been commissioned in Acts chapter 9, verse 15, to carry the name of Jesus to three groups: the Gentiles, their kings, and the people of Israel. And now, all three of these people are gathered in one location in the city of Jerusalem in opposition to Paul. Let's look at this in Acts chapter 25, verses 23 and following. It says, the next day, Agrippa and Bernice came with great pomp and entered the audience room with the high-ranking officers and the leading men of the city. And at the command of Festus, Paul was brought in. Festus said, King Agrippa and all who are present with us, you see this man. The whole Jewish community has petitioned me about him in Jerusalem and here in Caesarea, shouting that he ought not to live any longer. I found he had done nothing deserving of death, but because he made his appeal to the emperor, I decided to send him to Rome. But I have nothing definite to write to his majesty about him. Therefore, I have brought him before all of you, and especially before you, King Agrippa, so that as a result of this investigation, I may have something to write, for I think it is unreasonable to send on a prisoner without specifying the charges against him. And then Agrippa said to Paul, you have permission to speak for yourself. You see, Paul was no stranger to opposition. He had faced plenty of that in his ministry. But now, all of the opposition was in one place at one time, surrounding him like a vicious pack of wolves. And so what would Paul do? Well, with his back against the wall, he was strengthened in the face of opposition. And what I want us to do today is to see how he did that so that we can learn how to do that. And the first thing is this: you can be strengthened in faith by repeating your God story. The accusations against Paul had been threefold. They were sedition, sectarianism, and sacrilege. The sedition was the fact that Paul was accused of stirring up dissension among the Jews. The sectarianism was the fact that he was then accused of being a ringleader of the Christians. The sacrilege came in that he was accused of trying to desecrate the temple. Now, all of these charges were false. Either they were completely fabricated or they were just gross exaggerations of the truth. But since Paul had really no actual charges under Roman law to defend himself against, he instead used this public forum to share his personal story, to share his testimony, his God story. And so he begins with his current context in verse 2. He says, King Agrippa, I consider myself fortunate to stand before you today as I make my defense against all the accusations of the Jews, and especially so because you are well acquainted with all the Jewish customs and controversies. Therefore, I beg you to listen to me patiently. The Jews all know the way I have lived ever since I was a child, from the beginning of my life in my own country and also in Jerusalem. They've known me for a long time and can testify, if they're willing, that according to the strictest sect of religion, I lived as a Pharisee. Paul points out to King Agrippa that he was a good Jew. He was the strictest of the strict, and everyone knew that if they were willing to admit it. Well, then he continues to say that, you know what, not only was I a good Jew, but I was just as opposed to this Jesus as many of them are. Look down at verse 9 and following. He says, I too was convinced that I ought to do all that was possible to oppose the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And that is just what I did in Jerusalem. On the authority of the chief priest, I put many of the saints in prison. And when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. Many a time I went from one synagogue to another to have them punished, and I tried to force them to blaspheme. In my obsession against them, I even went to foreign cities to persecute them. No one hearing such a testimony of Paul's radical rebellion and his fight against Christianity could say that he was not, at least at some point, a committed Jew. The problem was something had changed. Something had changed Paul from that murderous Paul into this missionary Paul. And so Paul explains what it was by talking about his conversion. Look in verse 12. He says, on one of those journeys, I was going to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priest. And about noon, O king, as I was on the road, I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, blazing around me and my companions. We all fell to the ground, and I heard a voice saying to me in Aramaic, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? It's hard for you to kick against the goads. And then I asked, who are you, Lord? I'm Jesus, whom you are persecuting, the Lord replied. Paul had a come to Jesus meeting with Jesus himself. And in that moment, he was transformed. He became a new believer. But why was Paul doing what he was doing now? What had caused him to go from a saved sinner to an ambitious saint? Well, it was his commission that God had given him. Jesus continued on in verse 16 there on the road to Damascus by saying, now get up and stand on your feet. I have appeared to you to anoint you as a servant and as a witness of what you have seen of me and what I will show you. I will rescue you from your own people and from the Gentiles. I am sending you to them. to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. When Jesus commissions you to do something, you have to do it. You're compelled to do it. You want to do it. And so then Paul explains his commitment to do just that. Look at verse 19. So then, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the vision from heaven, first to those in Damascus, then to those in Jerusalem and in all Judea and to the Gentiles also. I preached that they should repent and turn to God and prove their repentance by their deeds. That is why the Jews seized me in the temple courts and tried to kill me. But I've had God's help to this very day, and so I stand here and testify to small and great alike. I'm saying nothing beyond what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Christ would suffer, and as the first to rise from the dead, would proclaim light to his own people and to the Gentiles. Notice how just in a few words, Paul lays out the truth of the gospel. He connects it with the Old Testament, and he says, this is why I am doing what I am doing. I'm fulfilling my calling right here today. Paul's story can be outlined very simply in just those couple of words, four words I mentioned: context, conversion, commission, and commitment. He knew his story and shared it well. What many would consider a moment of devastating opposition became for Paul a divine opportunity. And he shared his story with the people there. Recounting his journey with Christ made him grow stronger in the faith, because it reminded him that just as Christ had been with him at every other point in his life, he was still with him right there. And nothing was going to happen to Paul one millimeter outside of the will of God. God was with him. So just as Paul was strengthened by repeating his God story, I encourage you to be encouraged and strengthened by repeating your God story. If you're a believer, when was the last time you told your story to someone? But you just sat down and shared your testimony. I don't care if it's a G-rated story like mine of a church kid who finally realized church wasn't enough, or if it's a R-rated story with all kinds of bad decisions and sins before you met Jesus. Whatever your story is, it is interesting and it is powerful, because it is your story of walking with the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want you to do something this week. If you've never written down your story, I want you to do that. You can use Paul's outline. You can begin with that context, where you are now. Then you can talk about your conversion, how you came to faith in Christ to kind of get where you are now. Then you can talk about how the Lord commissioned you in some way to use what he did in your life in your life that you're living now, and then you can talk about your commitment to that. Just your story with God. And write that down. I guarantee you that taking time to write that down is going to strengthen your faith, because you're going to remember who Jesus is to you. You're going to remember what he's done to you. Because, you see, you can't repeat your story if you haven't reflected on your story. So write it down this week. And then I want to make an additional request. I want you to take a moment and email it to me, or mail it to me, or drop it off here at the church, because I want to read the stories of our church family. I think that would be amazing to be able to see how God has taken people through. You can be strengthened in the faith by repeating your God story. But there's a second step, a second truth that I want you to see in Paul's story today, and that is this: you can be strengthened in faith by reaching for the ultimate goal. Paul's story strengthened his faith in the face of opposition, but that story was largely what God had done in the past. I mean, even what God does right now is now past. The moment, the present, only lasts for an instant, but the future is still to come. We need to set our eyes on the ultimate goal. And so that's what Paul did. But what was that ultimate goal that he kept looking for? Well, let's see what that is. It's interesting that as Paul shared his defense, Festus interrupted him in verse 24. It says, "You're out of your mind, Paul. Your great learning is driving you insane." It's like Festus is saying, "Paul, you're so smart, you're crazy. You're so committed, you've gone insane. I can't take any more of your babbling. I don't understand why you've gone through all these imprisonments, all these trials, all this mess you're going through right now for something that seems to be such a non-issue. Man, you must be insane. Well, Paul explains himself in verses 25 and following. I'm not insane, most excellent Festus. What I am saying is true and reasonable. The king is familiar with these things, and I can speak freely to him. I'm convinced that none of this has escaped his notice because it was not done in a corner. You see, everything Paul had related was a matter of public knowledge. Jesus had been a well-known teacher and preacher in and around Jerusalem. The Christian movement was several decades old at this point. Jesus' corpse had never been found. And no one had come up with an adequate explanation for the resurrection. And in addition to that, the meteoric rise of the church could not be explained except for the fact of the resurrection. So with all this information out there that Festus was kind of questioning, Paul turns back to Agrippa and he lays a question at him. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know you do. See, Paul has laid out everything. His story with God, which no one can discount your story with God. He's laid out the truths. He's laid out the fact of Jesus, the fact of the prophets, the fact of the resurrection, the fact of the growth of the church. And no one could argue with that either. And so Paul then turns to Agrippa and says, you know, King, what's it going to be? What's it going to be? You've got all this evidence. What's it going to be? Now, in my mind of kind of envisioning how this story was going, I imagine that King Agrippa had been kind of leaning forward at his throne, kind of listening to Paul as he shared. And with that question, he sits back and then he makes this reply to Paul. Verse 28, do you think that in such a short time you can persuade me to be a Christian? Paul, do I hear just as I am playing in the background? What are you doing? Do you think you can do this in this little bit of time? Remember what's so cool about this. Paul was remembering his ultimate goal. And look at what he says in verse 29. King, short time or long, I pray God that not only you, but all who are listening to me today may become what I am, except for these chains. Standing all around Paul were the very people to whom he had been commissioned to preach. The Gentiles, their kings, and the people of Israel. And all around him there was just a bunch of opposition. And so he stated his goal, which was for those people to come to faith in Jesus Christ and to be saved just as he was. He wanted them to have that same relationship that he had. He just wanted them to be exactly like he was, except not be chained up. And that's pretty amazing. Because you see, they hated him. But he didn't hate them. They wanted to kill him. He didn't want to kill them. In fact, he knew that without Jesus, they were facing eternity in a devil's hell. And he didn't want that for them. Though they were his enemies, he wanted them to be saved. That ultimate goal of sharing the gospel strengthened Paul's faith. And we must pursue that goal as well. There's something about sharing the gospel that invigorates you. When you see people come to faith in Jesus Christ, you want to see it happen again. When you see the Lord move in a family's life and the power of the gospel transform a family, you want to see it happen again and again and again. And you come to realize that God's word is powerful. And yes, sometimes it really is enough to read the Bible, pray, and go to church. Sometimes that really does totally transform a person's life. And because you're holding out that ultimate goal of seeking the gospel, people's lives become transformed and you get strengthened in the faith, just as Paul was. So I've already asked you to do one thing this week, write down your story with God and let me see it. But here's the second. You probably know what it's going to be. Share your story with somebody. There's somebody in your life who doesn't have a personal relationship with Jesus, who needs to hear your story. Maybe it's a family member, one of your kids or your spouse or a sibling or maybe even your parents. Or maybe it's a friend at school or at work. But I encourage you this week to share your story with them. Pull that person aside and say, you know what, let's go to lunch or let's grab a coffee or let's grab some ice cream and let's hang out together for just a moment. I want to tell you my story with God. And just tell him what he's done. Walk through your story. And then you can simply ask, you know what, do you have a story like that? Because I want you to have the kind of relationship with the Lord that I have. And so if you don't, I'd like to share with you right now how you can have that relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And then you can share with them those ABCs that we teach the kids in Bible school. It's really easy, right? Admit you're a sinner, believe that Jesus is who he says he is, and confess your faith in Jesus as your Lord. It's very simple. Here's what struck me as I thought about that challenge and giving you that challenge this week. Do you realize how many people could come to faith in Jesus Christ just this week? We've had two services this morning. People have heard the message. We've streamed it out twice. It's going to live online. It's going to be on KLAX next Sunday morning at 10:30. All of these people hearing this message, what if we just told our story this week? Think about how many people in Central Louisiana and all across our nation, because of those people who watch online, could be saved this week. Wouldn't that be amazing? It could happen if we just do it. Just tell your story. That's what Paul did. He repeated the God story and reached for the goal. And so then what? Well, look what happened in verse 30. The king rose, and with him the governor and Bernice and those sitting with them. And they left the room, and while talking with one another, they said, "This man's not doing anything that deserves death or imprisonment." Agrippa said to Festus, "This man could have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar." So Paul lives another day. And then you know what happens? He gets sent to Rome on a government-funded mission trip. You see, Paul appealed to Caesar, so he's got to go to Rome. He's going to go there. He's going to be put under house arrest. He's going to be chained to a Roman guard for different parts of the day. All those Roman guards that cycled by Paul, you know they heard the gospel. And then Paul was able to preach at the house where he was kept. And he had all kind of people coming to him preaching there. The people of Jerusalem had tried to shut him up. But now he's at the center of Roman power preaching the gospel. Jesus had said, "You're going to proclaim me just as you have in Jerusalem all the way in Rome." You see, opposition isn't always a bad thing. Sometimes God uses it. He makes you get a little stronger. Just as in sports, a good opponent makes you practice a little harder, practice a little longer, get a little better. And in faith, it also makes you grow a little stronger. 2,000 years after these events that we've considered today, the guys like Felix and Festus and Agrippa, the members of the Sanhedrin, they're like the first round playoff contenders for the Super Bowl 30 years ago. Nobody knows who they are. Oh, you might be able to look it up in some kind of almanac somewhere, but even many of their names will be lost to history. But Paul is still a household name. And Paul's influence is still changing lives all around the world to this very day. So the question is, what kind of person do you want to be? Do you want to be the kind who is flabby in the faith and just fades into the dust of time? Or do you want to be the kind of believer who is fit in the faith and makes a difference for all time? You see, the choice is yours. So I challenge you to repeat your story. I challenge you to reach for the ultimate goal, and you will be strengthened in your faith no matter what kind of opposition comes your way. Keep pressing forward together. Let's pray together. Lord, we are so grateful for the the example of Paul. God, I don't see how he did it. I don't see how he just kept going, except for the power of the Holy Spirit within him. Lord, I pray that we would be like him. Lord, I pray that we would be bold in our faith. I pray that we would be strong in our faith and that we'd grow ever stronger every day. Lord, help us not to be flabby Western Christians, apathetical Bible Belt Christians. Lord, help us to be on fire, vibrant believers and followers of you. Lord, I pray that you would invigorate us and you would strengthen us in our faith. Lord, I pray for those in the room right now who've never trusted you as their Lord and Savior. They don't have a story. They don't have that time when you changed their life. And so, God, I pray that right now this would be the time when their life would be changed. And Holy Spirit, I pray that you would convict them right now. Help them to know of their need for you. And in this moment, help them to seek your face, praying a prayer that just simply admits their need for you, confesses their sin, and asks you to come into their life. Lord, transform them right now, just as you did Paul on the road to Damascus. And may they never be the same because of Jesus' name. Lord, I pray for others in this room who need to make a next step so they can be strengthened in their faith. Maybe that is to really commit to share their faith this week. Maybe it's to unite with this church family so that we can do life together. Lord, whatever it is that we need to do, speak to our hearts right now. Challenge us. You've been faithful to us. May we be faithful to you is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.